I want to know what Darda Star is, because Darda Star, which you just mentioned, is you got to have some humility out there. What's permeated your work from Jude Winitsky on is your humility about the complexity that's within the system.
Right.
Do they have humility on that, or we've forgotten that 10 years down the crisis?
Well, I think that's where the debate about the yield curve comes in. You know, what some in the Fed are saying is, well, the yield curve, perhaps it's been a good indicator in the past when it's inverted and recessions have occurred, but it's simply different this time. Ben Bernanke made that argument in 2006, and it turned out it wasn't different this time. The same argument, or you know, a similar argument, was made in the year 2000 when the yield curve inverted. It was supposed to be different that time because of fiscal surpluses. In 2006, it was the global savings glut. Back in 1989, then-Chair Greenspan told us different this time on the yield curve.
Drag it forward to now. What's the difference?
Now the argument is that distortions from ZIRP, NERP, and QE
mean the curve isn't going to work
as it once did. Here's the problem. The yield curve is a very long leading indicator. Inversions tend to presage recessions by 9 to 24 months. So it's not uncommon for an inversion to happen, and all the data looks good
still. I want to go to the second derivative. The bottom line here is the elasticity and the responsiveness of these dynamics is perceived to be different this time around. We're in control. I don't buy it for a minute.
I don't buy it either. I think the Fed needs to have a lot of humility, and it needs to keep its eye on forward-looking information, not just the coincident and lagging data coming out of the labor market. And that's really going to be the challenge. Not an easy thing to do. Much easier, you know, for me to sit here and direct and criticize than to actually, you know, for the Fed to actually lead. So I do appreciate that. But that's really the challenge that they face now going into the later innings of this tightening cycle.
Is the Fed taking less of a risk, though, in staying on the dovish side, Mike?
You know, I don't think, you know, they're as dovish as widely perceived. I think they're basically right on track. I mean, they've brought, you know, rates up now 175 basis points, almost 200 basis points. The balance sheet is now falling in a sustained way. A lot of people thought, you know, we would already either have a huge economic accident, you know, or some predicted massive inflation that never occurred. But the business cycle is doing well. Inflation's on target. And the Fed is in the throes of a sustained tightening, both with short rates and with the balance sheet. So I think they have policy about properly calibrated now. The key is going to be not to go too far, meaning don't be too dovish, don't be too hawkish. Try to approximate the so-called stars that you mentioned. And if they can do that, then nominal GDP will stay at a sustained growth rate, probably a bit below 4%. Now, we're running above that now, but as we mentioned, the bond market thinks we're probably going to see slower nominal growth next year, and that will be due to the lagged impact of Fed tightening. So I think they're on track.
Yeah.